The immersion of religion in popular culture is clearly evident today, and scholarly studies regarding the intersection of these subjects can be dated back to as early as the 19th century. In recent years, the dedication to this academic subject has become more and more significant to the overall study of religion. This is because popular culture is a major part of society today, a fact which can be seen in people's devotion to media consumption, such as social media, film, and television. FX's American Horror Story is one of the most unique television series that can be found on American television since 2012. Each season creates a whole new world of horror for the audience. The second season of AHS dives into a brutal world of sadistic nuns and evil scientists, of despair and madness. Welcome to the Asylum. The producers of the anthology series have eagerly stepped out of the box with creativity and complexity, holding nothing back. Asylum is a perfect example of a product of popular culture intersecting with religion in a unique and thought-provoking manner. As investigating journalist for this FX exposed documentary, I have made it my priority to attempt to decode the message co-creators Brad Falchuk and Ryan Murphy immerse within the art that is Asylum. The method of producer encoding and consumer decoding can be attributed to cultural theorist Stuart Hall. It's a theory that imposes many complex questions about perception and understanding, and variations of the two. The problem that arises from this cultural studies approach to popular culture is the following. What if the consumer is unable to decode the producer's intended meaning? Because of the incredible complexity of the anthological television series, we have decided to create a mini-series dedicated to exposing the encoded messages American Horror Story creators are begging us to decode. To begin our exposed documentary mini-series, we will be diving into the dark depths only a fallen angel can envision. Through this documentary, we will explore what co-creators and producers of AHS Asylum intended to encode when creating the shocking scenes of exorcism, demon possession, and the concept of death. Actress Lily Rabe introduces a different kind of darkness to the series when the spirit of the devil possesses her character, Sister Mary Eunice. The satanic quality that has noticeably overtaken the nun transforms her body, soul, and mind. From the moment the devil enters Sister Mary Eunice, her eyes can only be described as appearing possessed. It is from this moment on that the season transforms to center around the root of evil, the role of the temptation of sin in society, and the presence of satanic controversy found in the Catholic Church. The devil's incorporation into American popular culture has worked to lessen his status as the ultimate source of evil, because when Satan is represented on screen, one can dismiss the portrayal as a fabrication. Satan will never become secularized, because his existence is based in religion, but the possibility still exists that his incorporation into American popular culture has weakened the devil's terrifying qualities as assigned to him by the early church. The satanic focus is introduced in episode 2, Tricks and Treats, when a pair of desperate parents arrives at Briarcliff with their son who has completely changed in recent weeks, exhibiting terrifying and eerily strange behavior. After hearing the parents' plea for help, Sister Jude determines an exorcism is in order. Writer of The Devil Within, Possession and Exorcism in the Christian West, Brian Levick, researches social causes and meanings of these alleged demonic possessions, specifically in early modern European period. In an interview with University of Texas sponsored campaign, 15 Minute History, Levack talks about his knowledge on the subject. We are talking actually about a belief that certain things happened, but it is a belief that the devil, Satan, or one of his subordinate demons, entered into the body of a human being and controlled that person's physical movements and also their mental faculties. There were various signs or symptoms of this invasion, because it really is an invasion against the person's will. The person would usually have violent convulsions. Then there were what we might call more verbal or linguistic symptoms of this invasion. And the main one is that they would start speaking in languages of which they had no previous knowledge, or they would speak in a very, very unnatural deep voice, which was interpreted as being the devil's voice. Or they would show contempt for sacred objects, and they would blaspheme. People who would say that the symptoms of possession were the product of some kind of physical or mental illness. You get these people all the way back in the 16th and 17th century, but then especially in the Age of Reason, and the 19th century, and the 20th century, especially among doctors and psychiatrists. This is the universal explanation of all of these cases of possession.
It is 1964, for God's sake. An exorcism, you can't be serious.
Times may have changed, Doctor, but the nature of evil has not.
This leads us to think about the devil's immersion into popular culture as a symbol and belief. The Journal of Religion and Film investigates medieval representations of a powerless Satan in modern American cinema, highlighting relevant material for our own discovery. In American films, the humanoid devil is usually portrayed as male. The representation of Satan during the Middle Ages was always male, because the popular imagination made the devil, like God, masculine. Except in obvious cases like Bedazzled, where the devil is clearly a woman, female demons are usually identified with succubi. This identification of Satan as male is so strong that the female figures are rarely recognized by modern viewers of the devil. It is interesting to view AHS's representation of the devil as a woman, changing history for the preconceived notion that identified it as male. The role of Sister Mary Eunice is a dark one that explores many facets that only Lily Rabb can successfully pull off. Playing a character that holds both such purity and vicious evil simultaneously must not have been an easy feat. Let's take a look at what Lily Rabb had to say about her role as Sister Mary Eunice and the devil.
Went through the whole transformation. I mean, what are your thoughts on the aftermath of poor Sister Mary Eunice?
I think, to me, what was so kind of wonderful about the possession was the metaphor of, you know, when something takes you over that is that dark. If she had survived, what really would be left of her? You know, I think the fact that it was, you know, it's an assisted suicide, really. She wants to go because I think it's that, you know, when you've, and I think that is kind of an amazing metaphor for life of, you know, when something so horrible happens over such a long period of time, you know, what really is left of that person? How much strength does it take to sort of still be intact? And she, at the end of the day, there was nothing really for her to hope for except to just end it. And I think that, you know, it's really devastating, but it was very beautiful to sort of go through that and not have it be some sort of glorious ending of another exorcism and then she's back to herself or she's had, you know, just totally destroyed, as you know, as much of a reality as we have in American Horror Story. But
the Angel of Death proposes an altered view of the typical image of the symbolic entity in religious and pop culture history. The magnificent Frances Conroy portrays the fallen angel, Lucifer's cousin. But although her character is dressed in all black, she doesn't represent only darkness. Throughout the series, many of Briarcliff's patients and staff experience their own unique encounters with the Angel of Death. The Angel of Death is an obvious symbol for the ending of life itself. It can be speculated that AHS's particular portrayal is a complex symbol of fear, comfort, peace, but most of all, hope for a better reality. Scenes that feature Shahan, whose name means to destroy or ruin, are usually feeling just that, and seek her kiss of death for peace from their despair. In Genesis 6:11-13, This entity is described in the following way. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on earth had corrupted their ways. So God said to Noah, I am going to put an end to all people, for the earth is filled with violence because of them. I am surely going to destroy both of them and the earth. To provide some context, God is cleansing the world of evil and perversion. This is in direct reference to Cain and his descendants of hybrids, or what society has described them since biblical times, monsters. It is possible the co-creators of AHS have used their character Shahan as a metaphor of ridding the world of the monsters that reside in Briarcliff. Asylum's script assures, Shahan only appears when she is called, and whomever calls her and is ready receives her kiss of death, serving much like a Grim Reaper. The symbol of the Grim Reaper is an image our society is accustomed to seeing in popular culture. In fact, Disney released an authentically dark adaptation of Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol in 2009. There is a particular scene that features a stark black, aggressive-looking horse who flashes his glowing red eyes at Scrooge. There is a striking resemblance between the possessed horse and the demonized Sister Mary Eunice. This lends to the notion that part of what defines us as human is our ability to feel love and possess empathy. It is the equally empty look in a possessed thing's eyes that allows the comparison. Shahan and the Ghost of Christmas Yet to Come also share similarities. There is the fluidity of their dark flowing costumes and black shade, along with an experience of mysticism they both bring. This description resembles another character belonging to one of the most mass-consumed film series in history. Harry Potter also features dark subject matter, along with the ever-looming existential question of death. Among these similarities lies yet another example of the Angel of Death, Dementors. Dementors are among the foulest creatures that walk this earth. They infest the darkest, filthiest places. They glory in decay and despair. They drain peace, hope, and happiness out of the air around them. Get too near a Dementor, and every good feeling, every happy memory will be sucked out of you. If it can, the Dementor will feed on you long enough to reduce you to something like itself, soulless and evil. You will be left with nothing but the worst experiences of your life. The Dementor is another modern monster that is inspired by the commercialized version of the angel in question. It could easily be concluded these fictional entities share a type of genealogy and can be considered cousins.
Who's there? Who dares look upon Shahan? Show yourself. You did what you had to do, now leave. What are you that you can look upon me? I'm just a simple nun. A nun, perhaps. But not so simple. Something else resides in you. One like me, but fallen. Cousin.
I am no cousin of yours. Now leave this place, you're not wanted here.
I was invited, unlike you. Do you know why you seek me out, cousin?
I don't seek you out. What would you do? Or some part of you? The part that used to be pure. The human girl you've taken hostage sings to me.
No! No, heavenly host! Will you release me? Can you release me?
Oh, shut up, you stupid shell!
Lucifer is angered at the comparison. It does not want to be associated with an ally of God. Similarly to Shahan, the Dementor's kiss leaves its victims in a type of death, a condition one may consider even
comparing
worse,
all three supernatural
a type of vegetative state. Some found in religious history, others in popular cultures. All pose the question, why are we, as humans, so fascinated by horrific scenes or symbols? The Journal of Religion and Film's article exploring the images of the religious in horror films best describes the reasoning behind our fixation with the sacred and profane. Horror is the film genre least amenable to religious sensibilities. It offends, disgusts, frightens, and features the profane, often in gruesome and ghastly proportions. Yet, from the earliest Faustian dramas, to vampire legends and accounts of demon possession, to more recent apocalyptic nightmares, horror films have tended to rely heavily on religious themes, symbols, rituals, persons, and places. That is, of course, due, at least in part, to the fact that many of the central themes of horror films overlap with traditionally religious concerns, or at least Western religious concerns, such as sin and redemption, life after death, the struggle between evil and good, or the presence of the supernatural. It appears the most positive portrayal of the angel of death is found in American Horror Story Asylum. Actor Evan Peters, whose character Kit Walker never experiences an encounter with the angel, describes her in a positive tone.
In episode 7, Frances Conroy comes and she plays a character named the Woman, but she's the angel of death.
And she kisses you, you die. That's it. That's your rite of passage into heaven or hell or wherever she takes you.
Shall I kiss you and make this all go away?
Well, there are many people that die in this episode. And this woman, she's known as the Woman, appears because they summon her. They bring her to them at their moment of death.
I think the Woman is a saint or an angel. Because she's clothed in black and has black wings, she might be perceived as evil, but I think ultimately she's a good person or good entity.
Just let go. I'm right here with you.
This religiously created being that has been influenced by popular culture emulates Christianity's good angel of death, the Archangel Michael. In the Old Testament, Michael was assigned the reception of the immortal spirits when released by death. Therefore, in the hour of death, he is to be invoked by the faithful, Daniel 12:1-3. This is in accordance to AHS's representation, as Shahan only comes when she is summoned. Saint Michael is considered the angel of death for Jewish, Christian, and Islamic traditions. In the New Testament, Michael leads God's armies against Satan's forces in the book of Revelation, wherein during the war in heaven he defeats Satan. Characters Sister Jude, Lana Winters, and Grace Burton all experience intimate moments with Shahan in desperate periods of their life, when they are playing with the sharp edge of death. The writers of American Horror Story seem to employ William James's varieties of religions during the imaginative, mystical scenes that are graced with the angel's presence. James believes that religious experiences, particularly those associated with mysticism or feelings of transcendence or union with the divine, were psychological experiences that could be made sense of with psychological theory outside of any theological attachment. Because this representation is found in a fictional product of popular culture, these experiences are real for the individual, but do not point to any universal truth.
I thought she was such an interesting character because she, of course, played such a profound role in each person's moment, that given moment. So it was more just being a benign presence, helping that person feel comforting, not frightened. Anything that helps someone, I tried to do, and all the situations were different. Sometimes someone was in pain. Sometimes someone was really frightened. So it was sort of like helping that person and letting them go. It was really beautiful to play.
Our exclusive interview with anthropologist Clifford Gertz breaks down part of his 5-point definition of religion to help us better understand the religious influences immersed in this television miniseries. Welcome to FX Exposed, Professor Gertz. We are thrilled to hear your insights on this intersection of religion and popular culture.
My five-point definition of religion is well represented on the small screen of American Horror Story Asylum. Firstly, within Briarcliff, there exists a system of symbols which acts to establish power, a system which immerses mentally ill patients in the Christian religion, attempting to pray out the demon that lays within. And it's interesting because the show is, to a limited extent, based on what actually occurred up until the 1960s. And in Briarcliff, just as in those hospitals which existed in reality, many mentally ill were considered hopeless souls that only God could save. Briarcliff also acts to establish long-lasting moods and motivations in people by formulating conceptions of a general order of existence and clothing these misconceptions with such an aura of factuality that the moods and motivations seem uniquely realistic. This is exclusively demonstrated through characters Monsignor Timothy Howard and Sister Jude, the head and administrator of the institution. Jude's attitude towards sin is motivated by her Christian interpretation of reality. This justifies, in her eyes, why she uses cruel forms of punishment for their sin. This is particularly noticeable during her scenes employing the use of the cane, a popular form of punishment used by Catholic institutions historically and when ordering the sterilization of both Kit Walker and Grace Bertrand after finding them having sex. Now, the symbol of the cross is one that appears countless times in the second season of AHS. The symbol is any object, act, event, quality, or relation which serves as a vehicle for a conception, tangible formulations of notions, abstractions from experience, fixed and perceptible forms, concrete embodiments of ideas, attitudes, judgments, longings, or beliefs. A salient example of the cross acting as a meaningful symbol in the show is in the scene where Sister Mary Eunice, who is possessed by the devil, promiscuously performs a controversial song in a teasing fashion directed to the cross, and by extension, God.
You don't own me. I'm not just one of your many toys. You don't own me. Don't say I can't go with other boys. And don't tell me what to do. And don't tell me what to say. And please, when I go out with you, don't.
Also employs my colleague and cultural theorist Stuart Hall and his idea of producer encoding and consumer decoding. The use of the color red in the season has direct correspondence to the idea of sin, especially in the form of sex. Throughout Asylum, both Sister Jude and Sister Mary Eunice wear red lingerie and ravish me red lipstick that serve as tempting signals for sex. This can be something AHS producers intentionally encoded, hoping the consumer would recognize that sign.
What's that on your face?
On your mouth, to be exact. I might have been mistaken.
tastes rich.
Put that wine down.
You look like a streetwalker. Are you wearing lipstick?
It's called Ravish Me Red. It suits my porcelain complexion, don't
Hand
you think?
It over. Oh, it's for you, actually.
I hope you don't mind that I tried it first.
We don't wear makeup.
Overall, American Horror Story Asylum has successfully demonstrated in film that religion is a system or pattern of symbolic activities, not random, isolated, discrete symbols. The meanings assigned to particular symbols are related to others and explain the relations of the objects of experience so described. I think that this documentary is going to be very eye-opening, and I'm glad to have taken part in it.
David Tridister argues that popular culture should not be viewed as superficial, but concerned with the very serious work of identity construction and meaning-making, much like religion. There will be overlaps, parallels, contrasts, and other relationships between what we understand as popular culture and religion. Here at FX Exposed, we believe this is the case for American Horror Story's depiction of the historical yet modern representation of the Angel of Death, Shahan. In addition, the moments of exorcism and demonic possession employs the five-point definition of religion attributed to our guest star, Professor Gertz. This FX Exposed documentary hopes to have successfully decoded American Horror Story's second anthological season, Asylum, and its producer's intent in regards to these three thematic elements.